anytime you want to go to speech. So we have not done speech one, but if we had done speech one, as I mentioned before, there are certain commonalities to speech one that will persist with all your other speeches, including having an outline, having main points, having a text-free introduction and text-free conclusion, right? Now, for all your future speeches, you're going to have similar things, but you're going to have some additional things. You remember this poster with a speech as an iceberg. You remember I said that the part of the speech that people see and hear is this part, but all these other parts make it possible, and the better that these are, the better this will be. So for speech one, you definitely did some thinking in order to choose what you were going to talk about. You definitely did some writing. You put together an outline. And probably you did some practicing, even if you didn't end up doing the speech. So those are going to stay as elements of all your future speeches. But let's say, speech one was a very good speech, a very happy kind of speech. Now, wouldn't it be wonderful if you could make speech two even better than speech one?
Mm-hmm.
Right, okay, and then speech three and speech four and speech five and speech six and speech seven can also be better and better as you go along. How do you do that? It has to do with the elements of this chart that I haven't talked about yet, which are reading and talking. Now, when we talk about speech two, you know that it is a demonstration speech. That means you're going to be showing us how to do something. You may also talk about why you do it, and you may give background, you might give history, you might give an explanation of how you learned to do it. All those things are fine, but the main element of speech two is showing us how to do something. So you might think, well, I will have to think about that, I will have to write my outline, I will have to practice it, perhaps, but why would I have to read or talk about it? So I'm going to explain why and also how you'll be doing it. Does anyone have a topic already for speech two? Sure, many of you do. Yes, what is your topic?
How to cut hair.
Right, what kind of haircut are you going to... Tell me your name one more time.
Sean.
Sean, what kind of haircut are you going to give?
I'm going to just give a basic lineup to Marco.
Oh, okay, a basic lineup haircut. Now, for speech two, like all your other speeches, one of the first things you should do is determine what your main points are.
Okay.
So, because speech two is a process, you're going to say, do this, do this, do this. Usually the main points in speech two are going to be action verbs. What, do you have an idea what your main points are going to be?
Yeah, maintenance, the cleansing of the clipper, and just what points to start at on the head. That's
okay,
it.
I think you need some work on that.
Okay.
Maintenance is more information.
Okay.
Which is important, but it's not part of the demonstration.
What do you mean points then? Just where I'm going to start and at? Or?
Mm-hmm. The stages, probably.
Okay, okay. Yeah, yeah.
So to make it simple, let's just say... Start, process, and finish. Now, you might use different words, Sean, for this, but the idea in any process is that you have a beginning, a middle, and an end, right?
Right.
So, if you were going to be cooking, for instance, you might say, gather ingredients, mix, bake, and serve. Or if you're going to fix something, say, get your tools, repair by doing X, Y, and Z, and clean up, things like that. Okay, so the main points in a demonstration speech should almost always be the steps that you take in order to have something happen. Now, you remember that after you've got your main points and the sub-points there, then you decide what your introduction and conclusion are going to be. And you remember that the introduction... Yes, Sean?
I got a quick question. Sorry to interrupt you. Now, during the demonstration, do you actually do the demonstration or would you just...
You actually do it. Step? You actually do it, yes.
Okay. Right.
Now, I don't think I told you this, but the woman who helped me with the Open Course Library is from Highline Community College. Did I tell you about this? Which is, they have a lot of students who are going to go on to the University of Washington or Western and so forth. So they're heavily involved in majors like accounting and business, and they want to become sociologists or historians and so forth. So when I told her about this course and said that you get to do 7 speeches, she was astonished. She said, well, how do you have time for all the theory? And my answer was, we don't have time for all the theory. We don't talk about all the theory. We do the speeches. And then I told her that our second speech is this one, which is the demonstration speech. She said, you let the students work with manipulatives in speech 2? I said, yes, because here at Clover Park, people are ready to touch things early in the course. Whereas at Highline, evidently, they need to go through a lot of preparation before they are really ready for that. But this is a technical college. You don't have any trouble using your hands and touching things and moving things, right? Anyone here have trouble with that?
I don't think so.
Okay, so in speech 2, the essence of what you're doing is to touch and move something, actually. And there's some other reasons why I want this to happen. One of them is that it helps to let out some of your tension. When you move around, then all of the stuff that's built up inside you, still got me?
Mm-hmm.
All the stuff that's built up inside of you can be let out. Okay. Also, a speech in which you demonstrate something is usually a speech that you know something about, because I'm asking you to choose something that you do know something about. That's the reason for that. However, the link between that and reading is that if Sean's going to demonstrate how to cut hair, he might ask me or ask himself, why do I need to read anything about that? I know how to do that. It's not necessary. Well, you remember my motto? Maybe not.
Oh!
My motto is, the good is always the enemy of the better, which is why I drew the picture of the happy face and then the happier face. My view is that any speech can become better if you do certain things to it that weren't there. One of them is, always have an extra. Talked about the professor and the dog, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any speech that's like this can become better if you have this plus an extra. Any speech that's like this can become better if you have readings of some sort. But the question is, then, what do you read and why? So let's take Sean's example here. He's going to be talking about cutting hair. What might you read about to help make your speech better, Sean?
I guess how to deliver my speech. I'm not sure.
Okay.
In other words, I guess something like that. I'm pretty certain of what I want to talk about, so I don't have a really good idea what I need to read about. So.
Okay. Any suggestions from anyone else? Cece.
Basically, I'm going to start a haircut, maybe.
Okay.
What kind of haircuts you going to do? Maybe the tools that you need to have prepared.
I don't need to read, but I know how that.
Yeah, Sean is saying he already knows all that.
Yeah, what I need to read for if I already know that.
Any other suggestions from anyone? Rena.
Gather more information and, you know, you can watch videos, that way you can learn more, have more ideas, you know.
I'm glad we're doing
this. Yeah, but I thought this was what I need to read about. Something
yes.
About reading.
Dale.
I'm still kind of confused about this. We're going to give a speech that's a demonstration on how to do something. So are we physically going to do?
You
yes.
Are.
So he's going to bring somebody in here and cut their hair?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Or he's going to use a napkin. He's going to use Marco, yes. So don't choose something that you can't show us.
That you can't do.
So if you want to demonstrate how to weld a boiler on a ship, you can't do that. I mean, unless you're gonna take us to a ship or bring the ship into the classroom. No, choose something you can show us. Was there a hand over here? All right, well, let me get then to what I would suggest, Sean, that you read about.
Okay.
Do you know anything about when haircutting began?
Oh, no, not really. So,
okay.
Maybe that.
Okay. Do you know anything about the structure of hair?
Sure.
Okay, what do you know about it?
I know that there's different textures in hair.
Yeah.
And there's different measures that you need to take to type, cut different types.
How do you know that?
Because I've been through a course on haircut.
And what did you? Did someone tell you this?
Yeah, I was instructed by the instructor. Yeah.
Okay, so you already know about hair textures.
Right.
Okay. What do you know about hair cutting tools and implements?
I know the ones I need to use.
Okay. Do you know about any others?
Huh?
Do you know about any others?
If they not relevant in what I need them for, no.
Okay, but they could be relevant to your speech, couldn't they?
Maybe, yeah, sure.
Okay.
Okay, here's me.
Okay. Do you know how often people in the United States get haircuts?
I know how often my clients do. That's
okay, well, what about in the United States?
If they don't come to me, I'm printing out.
Okay,
I'm
but
not,
if you be,
not
but your audience might be interested in that.
Okay, well, I'll go
okay.
Ahead.
I'll call that demographics.
Okay.
So, for instance, how often does the average male get a haircut in
once
the United States?
Once
a week.
Black man.
Okay.
Black man.
All right, then there you've got some interesting statistics. You have statistics for black males, for black females, for Asians, for Hispanics, for Latinos. Okay, there are all kinds of things that you could do research on.
Okay.
So what I would suggest, this is a good example. What I would suggest, whatever you're going to be demonstrating, ask yourself,
okay,
what might be interesting about it that my audience would enjoy learning.
Okay.
Okay. Now, don't confuse this, however, with your main point.
Okay.
Now, it's possible that there's something you could read about one of your main points. Like if you're going to demonstrate how to cut hair, you might read something about what you need to do about oiling your clippers or something like that. But that's not the same thing often as this. This reading could be something that relates to the main points, but it could be something that is very generic, very general about your topic. Yes.
So when you go into your speech in the different sections of it, you could say, for instance, in such and such year, this person went and had a bad experience of a haircut.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. So the stuff that you got here is stuff that you know how to do, but you can make it more interesting by dropping in things that you've read about.
Okay.
Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. So, for instance, when you're developing your introduction, you're going to have your grabber, you're going to introduce the subject, you're going to list the main point, and then you're going to list the main points again and give a clincher here. Something you read about your topic could fit right in here, or it could fit somewhere in here. So for instance, you do some reading and you find out that Napoleon once said that a good haircut is next to a battle medallion for giving people confidence, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Then you could plot that in here as part of your grabber, as a quotation, or you could mention it here when you get to the finish, and you say, doesn't Marco look great? It reminds me of what Napoleon said about confidence from a haircut. Okay? Are there questions then about why you will be doing readings? Now, a question that will come up later on in the course, no matter what speech it is, from one person or two, will be, do I have to do readings for this speech? The answer is yes. In fact, if you look back there, is that it? No. Oh, up there, yes. Can you read that, Kevin, please?
A tight outline with...
Up above that, you know what it says?
Each and every speech.
Yes.
A tight outline with non-web citations in APA format. A completed interview sheet.
Right. So let their